Good evening, everybody, and welcome. My name is Sabir, and I run events here at the Strand. Before we launch into a discussion of Ty McCormick's newest book, Beyond the Sand and Sea, One Family's Quest for a Country to Call Home, I'd like to share a little bit of history about the Strand. The Strand was founded in 1927 by Benjamin Bass over on 4th Avenue's Book Row. Stretching from Union Square to Astor Place, Book Row gradually dwindled from 48 bookstores until, after 93 years, the Strand is the sole survivor, now run by third-generation owner Nancy Bass Wyden. We want to thank all of you for your support. Without our loyal community of book lovers and authors like Ty and George, we wouldn't be here today, and we are so appreciative of it. And so, tonight we are thrilled to have with us Ty McCormick for the launch of his newest book, Beyond the Sand and Sea. Ty is an editor at Foreign Affairs, the magazine published by the Council on Foreign Relations, a former foreign correspondent in Nairobi and before that in Cairo. He has reported for more than a dozen countries in Africa and the Middle East. He has written for the New York Times, the Washington Post, Newsweek, New Republic, and National Geographic, among others. From 2015 through 2018, he served as Africa editor of Foreign Policy magazine, where he led a team of journalists that won a Robert F. Kennedy Journalism Award for a series on African migration. He is a graduate of Stanford and Oxford. Joining Ty in conversation is George Packer. George is a staff writer at The Atlantic and the author of The Unwinding, winner of the National Book Award, The Assassin's Gate, and Our Man, a finalist for the Pulitzer Prize and winner of the Los Angeles Times Book Award for biography. His next book, Last Best Hope, will be published by FSG in June 2021. And so, without further ado, please join me in welcoming George and Ty to the stage.
Thanks, Sabir, and thanks to The Strand. I think Ty and I agree that we want to do all we can to support independent bookstores. And so I'm delighted to appear at a Strand event and to appear with Ty, who happens to be a colleague of my wife's at Foreign Affairs, and who is the author of a really compulsively readable and rich and beautifully written and important book, Beyond the Sand and Sea, which we're going to talk about tonight. So thank you all for joining us on a Thursday evening. And Ty, I want to throw it over to you and just ask you if you would read a bit at the start so that our audience can get a feel for the book, the language, the story, and then we'll take it from there.
Thanks, George. I guess first I want to say a really hearty thanks to you for being here. It's not an exaggeration to say that George is one of my literary heroes, so I sort of have to pinch myself that I get to appear at an event like this. But there's another reason that I'm really grateful to be in conversation with you, which is that you've written so beautifully about refugees and about displacement and those in government who have worked so hard, in the U.S. government, who've worked so hard with varying degrees of success to accommodate them. As many in the audience will know, George's most recent book, Our Man, is a biography of the American diplomat Richard Holbrooke, who is this really kind of larger than life, egotistical, but also very idealistic guy who I think a lot of people don't realize how big of an impact he had in terms of pushing the United States to be a more welcoming place for refugees. Not only did he push the Carter administration to let a large number of folks fleeing violence in Southeast Asia into the country, he played a role in the passage of the 1980 Refugee Act, which tripled the number of admissions to annual refugee admissions to the country. And as you read in the book, it's an achievement that puts us to shame today. So I'm really pleased to be in conversation with you about my book, which deals with a lot of the same terrain. And I'm really grateful to The Strand for hosting this. I will echo your push to support independent booksellers in this time during the pandemic when a lot of them are really struggling. I hope you wander over to the website and buy a book. I hope you buy my book. I hope you buy George's book, all of his books maybe. Really think about supporting a business that we really couldn't do without. So now I will actually read. That was very long-winded.
Nice.
But this is a passage from the introduction to the book. As he stood in line for immigration at John F. Kennedy International Airport, Asad Hussein tried to recall the final stanza of a poem by William Ernest Henley. In front of him, over the heads of a dozen disheveled travelers, stood a row of glass cubicles marking the border of the United States. Unremarkable of it as it must have seemed to the other travelers that day, the sterile, fluorescent-lit gateway to America felt surreal to him. Years before, in a desert refugee camp in East Africa, he had scrawled the poem on a slab of sheet metal he had used to keep the sand from blowing into his tent. Henley's words had famously sustained Nelson Mandela during his long imprisonment on Robben Island, and Asad had sought in them a similar source of inspiration. He had hoped they would strengthen his resolve to one day reach the United States. It matters not how straight the gate, how charged with punishments the scroll. I am the master of my fate. I am the captain of my soul. How many times had he read those lines, growing up a citizen of nowhere in the world's largest refugee camp? A sea of sand and thorn scrub and makeshift tarpaulin dwellings in the dry badlands of northeast Kenya, the camp had been home to more than 500,000 people at one point, a city the size of Kansas City or Atlanta, except without electricity or running water. There were no paved roads, no two-story buildings, no permanent structures of any kind. Most of the refugees had fled the war in neighboring Somalia, but a growing number, like Asad, had been born in the camp and never seen their home country. Members of this new generation had spent their entire lives in limbo, everything from the food rations that kept them alive to the arcane resettlement process that offered the only hope of a better future, hinged on the whimsy of distant powers. In Dadaab refugee camp, no one is master of his fate. Yet somehow, after 22 years of waiting, Asad had made it here. In his back pocket was a UN-issued travel document that contained a student visa. Tucked inside the document's light blue jacket was a form stating the impossible. He had been admitted to Princeton University and awarded a scholarship worth $70,000 a year. It was more than his entire family, perhaps his entire block in Dadaab, had ever seen in their lives, and so improbable that he hadn't allowed himself to fully process what it meant. He didn't dare. Too many times he had been on the cusp of breaking free from Dadaab, only to have it re-ensnare him at the last moment. There was the promise from the UN Refugee Agency of resettlement in the United States that had gone unfulfilled for 13 years. The prestigious Canadian scholarship he had devoted his entire childhood to winning, only to fall short of the grade, and the desperate attempt to smuggle himself out of the camp that had ended with him behind bars. Then came the executive order by President Donald Trump that shook Dadaab like an exploding mortar shell. Just days before his parents were scheduled for an interview at the U.S. Embassy in the Kenyan capital of Nairobi, the final step in the arduous vetting process for green cards, the United States had suspended all refugee admissions and banned travelers from seven Muslim-majority countries, including Somalia. Now, as the customs line inched forward, he felt sure that someone would snatch this opportunity from him as well. The Trump travel ban wasn't supposed to apply to him, since he had been born in Kenya and granted a student visa. But he knew that the agents at the border had the final say on who entered the United States, and there were plenty of reasons they might turn away a 22-year-old ethnic Somali man. Already, a mysterious American official had intercepted him on the layover in Frankfurt. She had peppered him with questions, some of them surprisingly blunt. "Have you ever been a member of an extremist organization? Do you know anyone who's been a member of an extremist organization?" With each shuffle forward, Assad's anxiety grew. By the time he reached the front of the line and a young Latino agent with a crew cut beckoned with a pair of raised fingers, he could feel himself freezing up, the hint of a childhood stammer creeping back into his voice. "Just answer the questions the way you've practiced," he told himself. "Look the agent in the eye, smile." The first few questions were pro forma. What did he plan to study? Was this his first trip to the United States? The agent swiveled in his chair to face his computer screen. His sullen expression gave no hint as to what he was reading, but as the minutes dragged on, Asad was gradually overcome with a feeling of dread. Then, without warning, a light above him began to blink red. "Would you come this way, please?" the agent said, stepping out from behind the desk and gesturing to a dimly lit hallway at the end of a row of cubicles. "We'd just like to ask you a few more questions."
Ty, did you do the audio version? Because you're really a good reader.
I did not. The wonderful audiobook reader Will Dameron did the audiobook, which I was very excited about.
That's the opening of the book, and our listeners can gain a sense right away of how intense, intimate, and really riveting the book is. You cannot stop turning the pages. You need to know what happens next, but you also feel this incredible closeness from the very first sentence to Asad, which is quite an achievement. So what I'd like to start with is, tell us who this is. Who is your protagonist? Where does he come from? What is it about his situation and story that made you want to devote yourself to a book? And then we'll talk about how the story came to you.
So there are really two protagonists. There's Asad, and then there's his older sister, Maryan. And both of their stories run through the book kind of in parallel. And I think it's possible to imagine under different circumstances that they might have ended up in reverse roles. They have a lot of similar personality traits. They have a lot of similar abilities. They have a lot of differences as well. But I think the relationship that they have and the bond that they've forged over the years and the strength they've drawn from it is really what brings them through the odyssey that forms the bulk of the book. Asad is, well, I've never met anyone quite like him. He is, his character is really difficult to describe in some ways. He is just like endlessly curious about everything. His desire to learn about the outside world is sort of boundless. He was born in the camp that I described in the opening pages of the book, which is, it's a world into itself. It has, you know, almost none of the things we take for granted here. No electricity, no paved roads, none of those things. And so he had seen none of those things and discovered them through literature. He even without having had a taste of the outside world, he was sort of driven to learn about it.
Where did the literature come from?
So there was a library in the camp that had, the volumes were mainly donated by Western charities. It was a big stack of Reader's Digests and a kind of a hodgepodge of other things, some classics, some romance novels. He burned his way through that library, reading everything that he could get his hands on, and was really drawn to the works, I think, of immigrant writers that had come to the United States and thrived. And I think through them kind of gained this idea that that might be possible for him as well. It's also a narrative that Maryan reinforced. She was resettled to the United States first and would send back word, like telling him about what awaited in America. And saying, you know, in this country, you can be anything that you want, and helped him to sort of keep hope alive that he might one day be able to do that. But his whole life,
he was reading the classics too, right? He was reading Tolstoy and Orwell and Camus and Garcia Marquez. So he was truly a self-taught reader and writer at a really high level from a pretty young age.
And the ones you've named there are really the ones he gravitated toward, I think for reasons of having to do with the world he was immersed in. He was drawn to absurdism, I think, because life felt absurd in a lot of ways. He certainly could relate to Orwell. His whole life he's felt unpersoned, you know, as a refugee in a camp, in a country that doesn't recognize you as a full citizen, doesn't extend you any of the rights of its citizens, doesn't allow you to travel, doesn't allow you to work. I think that a lot of those things rang true to him. And so that's part of what I think. Are you getting a bit of feedback there on your end? I'm not sure whether that's on my end or your end.
I may be getting a little bit of trombone practice. I could put a stop to right now.
No, not at all. I was making sure that wasn't my... that was my microphone, but in any case, you know, I think the library was sort of one avenue that he was able to realize this real voracious curiosity. And I think there were lots of ways in his life in which he was pushing outward, always sort of expanding his frontier, whether that was traveling to Nairobi illegally in this sort of early first attempt to leave the camp. He ends up being arrested and his sister has to bail him out. to eventually finding a way to finish high school outside of the camp, to returning home to his parents' country of Somalia that he had never seen before, to eventually winning a place in an academic world that felt totally, alien from where he had come from.
Right. Tell us a bit of the story. Tell us how his sister came to the United States ahead of the family. What happened to the rest of the family waiting and waiting and waiting? It is an incredibly heartbreaking story of the limbo, the trap in which refugees find themselves when decisions are being made at levels they can never touch or imagine that control their fate and that are often heartless and even corrupt. So tell us a little bit about the story of Asad and how most of the book is really about hurdles that he has to clear and sometimes can't clear.
Yeah, I mean, this is a family that fled the civil war in Somalia in 1991 and arrived in Dadaab refugee camp in 1992 and watched it swell to become the largest refugee camp in the world by 2011. Even before then, they were promised, or the whole family was promised resettlement in the U.S., which is was common among his sub-clan. They were from a minority clan called the Ashraf, which was deemed to be at risk, certainly of persecution in Somalia, but also inside the camp, because a lot of those sort of patterns of the hierarchies kind of carried over into the camp. So along with the Somali Bantus, they were given preference to be resettled. But Maryan is the only one who gets resettled, partly because she's married and has her own case, and for reasons that we are able to unravel at the end of the book, they are trapped. Turns out because of this corrupt official who for his own reasons is trying to keep the family there. But they wait and they wait. Maryan goes to Arizona first in 2005. She expects her family to come immediately afterwards. And then fast forward all the way to 2017 on the eve of Trump's travel ban, they are still waiting. And at that point, Maryan has given up on the UN resettlement avenue, has sponsored her parents for green cards, going through this incredibly difficult process of proving to the state that she can afford it, paying thousands of dollars of legal fees, only for the Trump travel ban to derail them right at the last moment when they're supposed to be getting their visas. At that point, Asad is also kind of at the end of the road. He has spent his whole childhood trying to win a scholarship to get out of the camp. There's this Canadian scholarship that looms large, I think, for everyone in the camp. It's arguably one of the most generous scholarships in the world. You can take your whole family to Canada. And so everyone spends their childhood trying to win it. He falls short of that. He falls short of another scholarship that he hopes to win. And so he's basically in Nairobi kind of looking after his parents. And then at that point, his life is very much up in the air, what will happen next. And that's actually when he walked into my life. And the Trump travel ban is what brought us together, unfortunately. Go ahead.
Well, I was just going to say, so high stakes testing has a whole new meaning when it comes to Asad's life. For him, passing a test and getting good grades is the difference between spending the rest of his life in a refugee camp and having the chance to go to the West and study at a university.
It's true for everyone in these camps. It's all or nothing. It's one test that determines your whole life. And, even if you do extraordinarily well, there's no guarantee. There's another character in the book by the name of Becker, who is Assad's very best friend growing up. And they spend every waking moment, testing each other on all of their subjects. They call their study room, room 101, the torture chamber, Orwell reference. And he, Becker did very well on that exam. He scored well enough to win a scholarship that's given out by the German government called the DAFI. It's the German Albert Einstein Refugee Initiative. And he got to study for a degree in public health in Kenya, but because of the laws there, he's educated but no more qualified to work in the eyes of the Kenyan government. And he is also now struggling to figure out what's next for him and whether there's a way forward. There's really only one pathway out for half a dozen to a dozen kids every year, from the camp of, you know, at sometimes 500,000 people, there really are golden tickets, and everyone else has to wait on the sort of faceless bureaucracy to have any hope.
The picture of bureaucracy is quite devastating. I mean, there's petty corruption that has quite an evil effect, but there's also just the kind of indifference and sluggishness that seems like a form of cruelty. I have to say, your book did not make me want to keep writing checks to the UNHCR, the UN High Commission for Refugees, or the International Organization for Migration, which seemed like they were almost more in the role of captors than conduits out of the camp. So did getting deep into Assad's story surprise you when you found out how the agencies that we think of as humanitarian actually have a kind of, I don't want to compare them to ICE, but they don't seem a whole lot different from the kind of hard-faced, indifferent American immigration bureaucracies that we're more familiar with?
So I think that is maybe an overly harsh reading. That was certainly not my intention. And I don't think that on balance, either of those organizations is certainly not comparable to ICE during the Trump administration. They're not intentionally cruel organizations. They are organizations that are working with compromises that are, you know, they are ethically making, they're working in the best they can in a terrible situation, which is one that's created by a whole host of limitations. The West not wanting to pay enough to actually support these refugees, certainly not wanting to take in as many of them as they would need to in order to end encampment policies. You know, and the age of encampment that we live in is one that is as a result of this kind of uneasy compromise between host countries like Kenya, like Pakistan, these countries that are kind of relatively stable. They are maybe nearby to a conflict zone, and they're willing to accept a large amount of aid from Western nations in order to house people that the West, frankly, doesn't want to see wash up on its shores. And UNHCR is caught in the middle of all of that. It has to keep people alive on a day-to-day basis, but it also, is involved in things that certainly I think and that come through in the book that are really devastating for the people who have to deal with them day in and day out. And certainly the impersonal nature and the waiting and the lack of any kind of agency is I think the most painful thing for refugees that are caught there.
Well, you know, that's the main tension in the book, is the way refugees have lost all agency. You say in that opening, no one in Dadaab was master of his fate, and Assad's inextinguishable drive to be master of his fate, which will not be entirely crushed in spite of all the waiting, the bureaucracy, the bad luck. And just that, it's a book about the cruelty of fate and of the randomness of our lot in life and how you end up in one place or another and everything is decided from that. And yet also this flame in your main character, which won't go out, which is why I think it's so emotionally gripping.
You're right. And I think that the reason that it doesn't is that for Assad, the drive is purely intellectual. It's the one area where the bureaucracy can't reach. If it was instrumental, like it is for Becker or for some of the other characters, where they want an education so that they can get out, so that they can have a better future, then the bureaucracy can get you because it can hold you back. But if really what it is the life of the mind that drives you, then really it's just a matter of access to the internet and books. And I think for Assad, that is why he was able to overcome setback after setback after setback, is because for him, the world that mattered to him was mostly inside of his head. I think for 99.9% of other refugees, being dependent on a bureaucracy that doesn't care about you or appears not to care about you, there's just the one practice that I think is the most cruel and most difficult, is that it's not like somebody comes to your tent and says, your number is up. You now, you report for a medical exam, or your flight is tomorrow if you've been promised resettlement. You have to walk to a bulletin board that is outside of the UNHCR office, and you've got your case number, and it's written there, and somebody comes and tacks it up there, and there's no warning of when it will happen, how frequently you need to check that board. And there's another character in the book, which is Asad and Maryan's third brother, who is he's a tragic minor figure in the book. He sort of has succumbed to a sort of an addiction to a leaf called miraa that a lot of people chew. It's a kind of stimulant leaf. It's common in Somalia. It's grown in Kenya and shipped to Somalia. When I talked to him in Kenya, really what I think broke him was years and years of going to this same bulletin board. And he would walk there every day and there would be no news. And that, I think, it's just a perfect encapsulation of the indifference of this bureaucracy, that there's no peering into it and saying, well, where, you can order Uber Eats and you can see where your Uber, where your meal is. You know, you can track it on the road in New York. You can't track your resettlement case. It goes into the system and then it disappears sometimes for 15 years and you will hear nothing.
And you might be sending emails to the void and the void might not write back or might write back, please be patient. Basically, yeah. There's no answer. Yeah.
And there are these emails that I quote in the book from Maryan that are just heartbreaking, that she would write in these sort of, she'd be stricken with grief, missing her family, feeling that, they were missing these critical years of her children. She had a new sister in Kenya. She regards these years as stolen. And she would write, if there is anyone there, my father was approved for a resettlement 7 years ago. He has tuberculosis. Like, please, I think I deserve some answers. And of course, there were never any answers.
And Maryan's story is the other half of it, because her story takes place in the United States and it's not an altogether happy story. In fact, not at all. She has a rough marriage. Her husband doesn't adjust very well to either the U.S. or to his wife being a free woman in the U.S. And that's sort of a foreshadowing perhaps of how once you get here as a refugee, you all that you've been striving for is finally given. And in a sense, you're only at the start of a very long journey.
Yeah, her journey was different in that sense. It's also interesting that she's the only one in the family that didn't grow up dreaming of America as this sort of mythical place. Mm. Asad writes about America, that people in the camp spoke about it the way they speak about the hereafter. But when Maryan lands in the U.S., it's pretty early on in the story. And so they haven't kind of absorbed this mythology of American individualism yet. And so she arrives and IOM has like in her little carry-on package, it has a printed out version of the Star Spangled Banner. Those words, I think for her, they were sort of meaningless. And her American journey sort of started with a blank slate. And it was pretty much all of her effort was directed toward bringing her family with her. And she was this incredible rock for the family that, even before she came to the U.S., was working, was supporting the family, was forced to drop out of school because of abuse or harassment in school, and kind of played that same role of taking care of her family from abroad. When she was still in the camp, she was so fierce in defending her siblings that the neighbors called her Askari, which means soldier or warrior in Swahili. And so she continued to do that and to defend her family from the U.S. even for a decade and a half.
Tell us how you met Asad and how you decided to write a book about him.
So we met as a result of the travel ban. At the time I was the Africa editor at Foreign Policy magazine, and it was a news story that we needed to cover. And, at the time, basically, I either wrote the story or I assigned it to somebody else. And I had read an article in the New York Times a few months before that had been written by a young man that had grown up in Dadaab. And it was a short article about his sister coming home. And I thought it was beautiful. And I never in a million years did I think that the author would still be stranded in the camp. Mm. I thought he had been one of the lucky few to win the scholarship to go to Canada. So I filed away his name. I thought, you know, this is somebody I want to ask to write for me when I get the chance. And so when the news broke, I thought, this is perfect. You know, he grew up there. Surely he knows people who are affected. And so I sent him a message on Twitter. I said, you know, would you be interested in tracking down families that were expecting to be resettled, whose cases, you know, maybe they had a flight canceled, or the closer, you know, I wanted him to find people who were just on the cusp of being resettled. And he wrote back and he said, you know, that's my family. Like the entire world seems to be moving against us. And so, you know, I wrote him back and I said, you know, would you be interested in writing your own story? And so he wrote this beautiful, lyrical, just devastating essay for me at Foreign Policy about his family's, you know, quest to come to the US and the various ways in which they had been thwarted over the years. And so we actually met before that to talk about it, because he happened to be in Nairobi waiting for his parent, hoping his parents would you know, get resettled. And they stayed basically because Maryan had spent so much money, such an investment for them to try to get these green cards, that even after the Trump travel ban, they were going to wait and see if there was any way of getting through. So he was in Nairobi. We met at this, you know, this mall in Nairobi that's kind of this modern shopping center called Yaya Center. And we sat there over lattes and he told me a little bit of his story. And, you know, I sort of told him what I was looking for as an essay, and he filed this beautiful thing and we kept in touch afterwards. And I actually met him again because I needed to pay him. And it's the only time I've ever paid a writer with a wad of cash because he didn't have a bank account and no one in his family had a bank account. And that, I think after that, we just sort of struck up a friendship. I became the more I heard about his story, the more I became interested in writing about it. I must have known at the time, the very first time that I met him, that this was a potential story, because I came home and I typed up 5 or 6 pages of notes that I still have from that very first meeting.
This is a young man who, it's not like, oh, he's such a good writer for a boy who grew up in a refugee camp. No, this is a writer. He is, because of his reading, because of his intellect, and because of his desire to become a novelist, this is a guy who writes as if he was just born to it. And part of the drive throughout his life is that he aspires to what he's reading in the library in the refugee camp.
Yeah. And he has this endless ability to keep kind of summoning will. That one of the things he told me, and which appears in the book, is that during that year, around the time that I met him, the lead up to that first article in the New York Times being published, he had submitted something like 40 or 50 op-eds to the New York Times, all of which were rejected, and he just kept submitting them. And it was, you know, one of these very late instances when an editor finally wrote him back and said, well, what you've submitted isn't going to work, but we can come up with something to work together on. And it was the same thing he had done in the camp, which just blew me away, which was that the first time he saw a newspaper was at the butcher shop in the camp, in the place called Bosnia. And the meat would come wrapped in the newspaper. You can't get a newspaper in Dadaab. And so he would go and he would take the blood-soaked newspapers and he would read them. And there was a literary section in the Daily Nation that he would really hope for, that was the section that he would hope to get. And there were short stories there were book reviews, and he would read the book reviews. And at some point along the line, he started writing his own book reviews, and he found an email address on the Daily Nation's website, and he would submit them, and then he would go back to the butcher shop and hope to find book reviews. Maybe one of his would get published and come back. That never happened. He never found one, but he did in fact write things for the Daily Nation later on, including just a sort of comical letter to the editor that the Ministry of Education felt the need to rebut. he wrote complaining about the curriculum, that he said the curriculum was like numbing people's minds. And that it was, you know, it was geared around this test and there was no kind of imagination to it. And, you know, he really pissed off the people in the Ministry of Education who wrote back. And, you know, here he's thinking like, I don't even merit like an ID card. I don't exist in this entire, you know, I'm not actually allowed to go to school. Technically, I'm enrolled in school because I found somebody who will look the other way. 'Cause at that point he was outside of the camp. But here the Ministry of Information is writing back an official rebuttal to my letter to the editor.
Butcher's pay. I mean, it gives a whole new meaning to written in blood. That was the newspaper reading that he had to do. So you got quite involved in his life, not just as a journalist, meeting him umpteen times at that mall to get his story, but also helping him. And you talk about that in the book. I personally find absolutely nothing wrong with that and a lot to admire about it. But there, I think there's a kind of rigid code in journalism that you can't touch the person who's bleeding to death in front of you because it would affect the story, which you have to allow to take its course. It's something I've never quite understood or lived by, but I wonder how you navigated by your own lights the ethical questions that this relationship raised for you.
Yeah, that's right. The more I got to know him and the more I got to know the whole family, the less I felt like an objective, impartial observer. I think that even in day-to-day ordinary reporting, this sort of idea of objectivity gets twisted into a sort of absurd standard, you know, as we all bring our biases to whatever story we're covering. Some might even call them values. And I'm not really sure that it makes that much sense to spend all this time trying to check those values at the door. There are tools that, of course, are taught in journalism schools that are meant to sort of help you to keep your biases from shaping the story. I found at book length and the amount of time that you spend with a character in order to get any real sense of who they are, it becomes a real challenge, particularly when you have a power differential of the kind that we had. You know, he had no official status in Kenya. I had the ability to do anything I wanted. And I also had the ability to help. And so the idea that I would sort of step aside and not help when I had the ability to, I just realized that you have to ask yourself why you would adhere to these guidelines and who benefits from that. And I sort of came down on the side of, I'm not even going to try for objectivity in that sense. I'm going to try for honesty about the story that I'm telling and honesty about the story, my role in that story.
And I think the kind of objectivity that you can strive for, which is to see your subject as clearly and really as coldly as you can, and not to hide the complexity, including what might not be so lovely about it, which maybe is another word for honesty. And yet at the same time, to say this is a human being and I actually feel something for this human being and I'm not going to let him rot in Nairobi because he doesn't have the money to pay for the boarding school that might be able to get him out of here. So that seems like.
And I think we should also be careful not to overstate my role here. Like, this is, you know, Assad's story and his sort of meteoric trajectory are products of his own, you know, doing. My role was really as a facilitator in terms of like giving, you know, you need a credit card to fill out the common application. To apply, there's just endless hurdles that are designed to keep really the bulk of the people on this planet out of places like Princeton. And, you know, we made our way around some of those obstacles together, basically with me, you know, providing some resources. And I think that's the extent of my involvement beyond friendship. So I think there's sort of two issues here. There's facilitating and then there's friendship, both of which I think warp a traditional sense of objectivity. And I think my role as a narrator sort of changed to one who was rooting for the protagonist to end up, where he did. The other thing that bears saying here is that the end of this story was not determined when I set out to write this book. I had been working on the book for, more than a year before he was admitted to Princeton, possibly even longer than that. I'm not totally sure of the timeline off the top of my head. But it was, that whole process I had a front row seat to as a reporter, and was, sort of documenting his attempt to get into one of these universities. And so it happened that it worked out, but I was, I was very fearful that there was going to be a different result, and that, at the point that, he had been, it's sort of amazing. He didn't get into either 7 out of the 8 or 9 out of the 10 that he applied to. And the one he got into, it was like the last one that, that issued their decisions. And so, if I'm being honest, I was pretty pessimistic at that point. Like I thought there was almost no chance, because we were 0-7 or 0-8, and it seemed that there was clear. The problem was that he had no real academic record before this 1 year at Brookhouse. One of the problems we had even getting him into Brookhouse was that he had no official transcript from Dadaab, because all the teachers had fled because there was persistent insecurity in the camp. And so all of these kind of boxes that you need to take along the way, he oftentimes was just leaving them blank. Doesn't have an address, doesn't have a passport, doesn't have, he's got a religion. That was like the one that he could fill out on the Brookhouse application. But because of all of that, I thought for sure there was going to be another gap year, and that I felt optimistic that he could succeed in a year's time, but I was not expecting to hear positive news, and was actually out of the country at the time, and got this, this Twitter message from him, or maybe it was WhatsApp, I can't remember, with this acceptance. And I was just like blown away that this thing had worked.
There's a fairy tale quality to that moment. And yet it leaves you feeling both incredibly grateful to Princeton and also somewhat resentful that the arbitrary yes or no, the sort of, it could have gone the other way, that much power to control, the happiness of this incredible young man who deserves so much is in the hands of a university at the other end of the world. And that's part of what I felt throughout the book, which was just the sheer randomness and cruelty of the hands that are dealt us, and how little control we have over the hand. We do have control to some extent over how we play the hand, but you have to be an Asad, you have to have his character in order to play that hand and come out the way he did. So I'm gonna ask you one more question. I think we have to get to questions pretty quickly. So telling the audience, get your questions for Ty ready, because at 7:45 we'll go over to them. But one more thing, Ty, where does this story and your book leave us as Americans? Because again, it's a mixed feeling it gave me. On the one hand, there's so much wrong in this country, and especially when you were working on the book during the Trump years, in our relation to refugees, whom we pretty much turned our backs on during those years. And very few Americans would say I'm proud of the way we're dealing with oppressed people around the world. And yet we also learned from your book that 3/4 of the refugees who have been resettled around the world in the last couple of decades have ended up here. So America's doing far more than any other country. So at the same time, we had this incredibly cruel face in the person of our last president, and yet a tradition that is obviously real enough that people like Assad and his family see the United States as a real promised land. And that doesn't die at the end of the book. It remains a vision that he holds on to. So where do you think this leaves us, and how we should think about our posture toward refugees and toward oppressed people around the world who see us as their last hope?
Yeah, I mean, I think both of the things you've said are true. On the one hand, the U.S. has been the leader in refugee resettlement. I think that as a nation that sort of founded or organized around a set of ideals and ideas rather than an ethnocentric sort of notion of national identity, I think we're sort of always caught between our better and our worse angels, and this kind of perpetual tug of war that's playing out. When we live up to our ideals, we can be this beacon of hope around the world. And I think refugee resettlement is a real embodiment of that. I think there's an extent to which I think many Americans don't know just how powerful of a soft power tool refugee resettlement is, and just how it transforms people's impression of the country. I often say this, but I think that refugees often have a higher opinion of the country before they actually come here. That there are, and it's not really just about America as a land of opportunity, but that's part of it, but it's America as someone who extends a hand to those in need, and a real sense in which that is that's just appreciated by people who are in need. And during the Trump years, that goodwill was extinguished. When I was in Dadaab in 2019 doing research for the book, I can't describe to you how different the atmosphere was than it was in 2017, for instance, the first time that I went there.
Yeah,
there was just a sense that resettlement was dead, that America had turned its back on this camp. And we didn't really get a chance to get into what the camp is like, but it's arguably the place that was on a per capita basis most affected by the Trump travel ban. There were 14,000 people in the camp who were at some stage of the resettlement process when the Trump travel ban came down, and only 8 people were resettled in 2018 and 14 were resettled in 2019. So basically overnight, this huge, you know, the only thing that gave people hope in a lot of cases was extinguished.
In other words, we are not only hurting people who are already suffering a great deal by closing our doors, we're really hurting ourselves, because this is a way in which we make ourselves attractive to the rest of the world. And it's a way in which we have really shown, I think Asad talks about a beacon of hope, and he does it without irony. And that's something that's almost unheard of these days. And for that to be extinguished seems like the height of a kind of self-destructive act. We need to get
and,
to-
And there's another, sorry, I just want to add, there's a second part to it. It's not just about our image. It's about this idea of sort of self-improvement. And I think that that's another thing that a lot of people admire. I think a lot of refugees admire about this country. I think more so than almost any other country in the world, America is seen at least as a country that is committed to making itself better. And part of that process is being, is being welcoming to refugees, but it's also in a practical sense that the work of making yourself better is actually welcoming people like Asad and having them be, you know, being able to be a part of this country and to bring the skills that they are part of this renewal and this perpetual self-improvement. And so it's a sort of a dual process, I think.
So the first question's from James. During the last administration, the US adopted an America First policy, is what we've been talking about. This led to an outspoken right to cast refugees and immigrants as unwanted. In your opinion, what are some ways leaders in our country can shift away from this rhetoric and help unite our hyperpartisan society?
I mean, I would say that I think the Biden administration has kind of done that bit. The rhetoric has changed, I think, pretty markedly. He sort of said all the right things on the campaign trail. The problem, in my view, is that a lot of that hasn't actually been backed up yet with action. I think a lot of the things that Trump put in place are still, particularly to do with refugee resettlement, are still in place. And, you know, a few weeks ago, I think it was in February, Biden told Congress that he was going to raise the annual cap on refugee admissions, and the paperwork was drawn up, and the expectation was that they were going to raise it from 15,000 to about 60,000, and it just hasn't happened yet. And it was actually, I mean, the State Department was clearly expecting it to happen because they booked flights for 700 refugees to come here and then had to cancel them at the last minute. And it seems that, you know, from the outside, I have no window into what the White House is thinking, but it seems that it's become caught up in the politics of what's happening on the southern border. And there's a fear that if he raises the refugee cap, then he's going to get beat up for being soft on immigration. Yeah. So that I think he's speaking in a softer tone, but I think still carrying on a lot of the same policies.
During the campaign, he talked about raising the cap to 120,000, which is higher than it's ever been since the Refugee Act of 1980 that you mentioned. So I don't see the point in raising expectations and putting a target on yourself by simply using that number and then not following through. Next question. How did it feel to be able to leave the encampment, the refugee camp, when visiting him and to see him unable to leave until he did? From Ginny.
So that actually is not it's not something that happened because we met outside of the camp. So there was never a period where I was coming to visit him in the camp. In fact, I've only ever been in the camp with Maryan. And so I imagine that would have been very, very difficult if that had been the case. And it is difficult with other refugees that I have met and befriended who are stranded and, you know, don't have the option of traveling. By the time he and I struck up our friendship, he had found a lot of effective workarounds around the bureaucracy. And he was sort of operating in the gray zone and certainly risking being sent back there or shaken down for bribes, which happened frequently. But he was living effectively as an undocumented person in the largest city in Kenya.
And this is from Mafuz. Given the U.S. funding of Kenya's war in Somalia, how did that affect Assad's dream of coming to the U.S.? Did you feel any complicity as a U.S. citizen in your relationship with Assad?
Yeah, I mean, I'm sure that it played into you know, some of his calculus. He's very critical of American foreign policy, and I'm sure that he you know, would have choice words to say about American involvement in Somalia. I think I don't want to speak for him, but I suspect the main issue is less the counterterrorism operations and more. Well, actually, I don't want to speak for him, but the biggest sort of, I think, the biggest thing that America is complicit in, I think, clearly in Somalia was backing an Ethiopian invasion that toppled a pretty functional government in 2006. Somalia has not had a stable government since Siad Barre's regime collapsed in 1991. And then in sort of 2005, 2006, there were sort of the first glimmers of a stable government that was called the Islamic Courts Union. And it was basically a federation of jurists who had struck up an alliance with the business community and set up a way to impose some level of order. And there was less fighting. There was, you know, Becker, who was one of the characters in the book and who was in Somalia at that time, he recalls it as one of the only sort of periods of sustained normalcy in his life. And so that is, I think, because the U.S. was coming at it from a post 9/11 point of view, the Bush administration was worried about emerging pockets of terror. It partnered with Ethiopia, which for its own reasons was interested in imposing its influence in Somalia, and toppled that government and imposed a sort of pliant, internationally backed government in its place that then was just totally unable to control the space. And it gave, you know, huge swaths of territory to al-Shabaab, which now is the problem that the U.S. is trying to deal with, which is causing new refugee flows to come to Kenya. So all of that is a very long-winded way of saying that the U.S. has complicity on both ends. You know, it has a role in having displaced people there, and it has a role in paying for their maintenance in these refugee camps that are a very imperfect solution to a problem of displacement. And if it was, you know, I think, the only sort of real way to solve that problem would be to scale up resettlement to a level that actually made it a realistic dream for people to come. Amazingly, I don't think that it totally tarnished. It doesn't seem to totally tarnish a lot of people's view of the United States. I think they are able to distinguish between the government of the United States and the people and the culture that they've built, and that sort of the draw of being a part of that is still very real.
And I think we have time for one more question from Abi. And this is personal. Given the nature of your job, how do you cope with stories that can have an emotional toll? And this one, I'm sure, cost you some sleepless nights.
I don't really have a good answer to that. I think that some of my colleagues are more thoughtful about that kind of thing. I worry more about the people whose lives are affected. I think I've been lucky enough that I don't have a particular high level of trauma as a result of what I do. I worry about the people who are left behind in these places. And I keep in touch with a lot of them. I have a lot of Facebook friends from places all over the world that I've sort of collected and that I keep in touch with and I consider to be my friends. And I WhatsApp with Becker all the time. Becker, if you're on this call, how's it going? I where possible, I try to be helpful. I will always look at a resume. I will always try to make a connection at a university or something like that. I don't spend a lot of time worrying about myself.
I think doing the work is probably the best way to deal with whatever it might be, whatever effect it might be having on you, is just to keep doing the work. So I just want to tell everyone to buy this book, Beyond the Sand and Sea. It's wonderful, as you can gather from this conversation that I've been having with Ty. I hope Ty and the book have a brilliant success in the coming months. So, and thank you to the Strand for hosting us.
Thank you, George. This was really fun.
Thank you, Ty. And thank you, George, for a fantastic evening and a thoroughly engaging conversation. Thank you to our audience for spending your evening with us tonight. If you'd like to purchase Beyond the Sand and Sea, there's a green button center of your screen you can click on. We also dropped a link in the chat to pre-order George's forthcoming book, Last Best Hope. So again, thank you everyone and have a wonderful evening.